Today, my special guest is Seema, and she is in Mumbai in India. And she was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis in 2008 and has a very interesting story to tell us and how she was able to modify the Patterson program and get tremendous results and pain relief, which includes coming off sulfasalazine, which she was on for 2 years, no longer needing painkillers, which she was taking for the immense pain that she was in. And a lot of information that can help us around the way that she prepares the foods, which need to be a little bit different because she is in India. So Seema, thanks so much for coming on this podcast.
Thank you, Clint. I'm so grateful to be on this podcast. Thanks a lot for inviting me here. I feel so grateful and lucky to be here.
Well, thanks for coming on and sharing some tips that you're going to give us as to what's working. You've been able to, as I mentioned, get off some of these other medications, and now you've tapered your methotrexate from 15 milligram. You're now down to 5 milligram, which is your only drug that you're now taking, which is a big improvement from where you were. And so tell us what modifications and what changes have you had to make to the Patterson program to make it work for you, or has it just worked straight out of the box?
No, I had to make some modifications. Like earlier I was taking white rice, then when I switched to brown rice, then I saw some result. Later on, I also reduced spices. In India, we are used to making all the dishes with lot of masalas, garam masalas, red chili powder, and you will see all dishes are red in color, chole masala, chole puri, paneer masala, everything includes masala, even tea includes masala, especially for India, Maggi has introduced masala Maggi. So here, if there is no masala, people would not like it. But actually masala is hampering your digestive system. It inflames the lining of digestive system, due to which the problem of leaky gut cannot be solved. So that's why earlier, even on Patterson program, my mom, so that I could eat tasty food, she used to add masala on Patterson program recipes as well. So that's why I was not seeing faster results. But as soon as I did my own research and I found out that masala can cause inflammation, I immediately stopped, completely stopped. Not even a pinch of masala I would add. I did not care about taste. So slowly my taste bud changed. So now, even if there is no masala, I still love my food. So because taste buds modify, like you can train your taste bud according to your habits. Your every day what you eat, your taste buds are modified according to that. So apart from this, stopping the spices, I stopped onion and garlic because according to Sattvic diet, onion and garlic are categorized under tamo food. There are three gunas, Sattvic, Rajo and Tamo. Sattvic diet causes us to remain peaceful. Rajasic guna causes a lot of action. It is associated with action and passion. And tamoguna is associated with arrogance. Actually, we have all this guna, but in some proportion. But sattvic guna should be at higher proportion so that we are always peaceful and calm. Because our mind has direct impact on our body. If we are able to control our mind, then because you might be knowing about mind-body connection and psychosomatic diseases. Majority of diseases are occurring because of wrong thinking patterns. So when I started to change my thinking pattern, I started to love every single thing I'm doing. Though my body was in pain, I would consciously think positive thoughts. I would visualize positive things like your affirmation, pain-free, drug-free, back to maximum energy. So I would visualize, I'm pain-free. Though it has not already happened, but in my mind, it has already happened. So when I think positive, our brain cannot differentiate between what is real and what is imaginary. So when you imagine positive things, your brain releases chemicals in your body that helps in healing. Good hormones are released. So you are positive and always want to, you are, then you feel like doing exercise, because when you're negative, you will not even feel like doing that exercise. So many things have changed. And apart from this, most important is organic food. Then earlier, my celery, I was not able to find organic celery. So when I started to use organic celery and have organic juice, that also, I think, played a major role. Now, and in between, I thought everything is going fine. I'm not having pain. So I thought it's okay for some time. I will switch to inorganic. But I observed that pain returned when I switched to inorganic food. So now I have decided that I'll stick to organic food, because the chemicals that is being used is very harmful. And as we have suffered from this disease, our bodies and system organs are very sensitive to all these chemicals. So that's why I think the pain returns when you switch to inorganic food.
So you only
so I would suggest that everyone should stick to organic diet.
And is it easy to get organic foods in Mumbai?
Yes, in Mumbai it is easy. There is one place online called Organic Garden. And from there, I source all my organic food. Like even papayas, you get very tasty papaya. Like I've seen difference between inorganic papaya is not very tasty, but organic ones are very tasty. Yeah, there's a lot of difference between the taste.
And you found that the difference for you personally was that the pain you experienced was much less when you went organic 100%.
Yes.
Okay. Before I pick your brain more about mindset, I want to get more into that. I know you changed your job and everything to get the best results possible. How are your symptoms now compared to your symptoms when you were in the early stages?
Symptoms were horrible. Before Paddison program, symptoms were like very horrible. Once I switched to Paddison program, things were so much in control. I was able to get up from sofa without taking support. Earlier, I used to take support of chair or walls to get up from chair. But after switching to Paddison program, there was a lot of relief in pain. My pain, I used to mention in my journal, I'm feeling so painful. You used to tell me you push for exercise, and I used to push for exercise. Like your motivation helped me to come out of pain. And you told that your first goal should be to come out of NSAIDs. And when I improved my exercise, slowly my non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs came out and painkillers came out. It was so unbelievable for me. I shared on my journal as well. So. Then once that I used to go to gym also during that time, it was difficult. But because you told me, I used to stay on that track. And exercise is very helpful, because that is like a form of painkiller.
Yeah.
When you exercise, oxygen goes inside your body, and oxygen does not allow cancerous cell to expand in body. So it is very important it is very important that you are filled with oxygen with breathing and exercise.
In doing the exercise, as I encouraged you in the support group, and getting off those non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, did you notice that coming off the painkillers then actually helped you heal even more, because they may have been playing a bad role on your gut?
Yes, exactly. Painkillers cannot, when you are on painkillers, it is more causing more damage to your cells. And it has all the negative side effects on your body. Even your mind is not in your control. I think that's why most of the patients who are suffering from RA, they also get depressed over a period of time. So there is unimaginable side effects of the painkillers and steroids. Temporarily you might feel some relief, But on long-term basis, it is hampering your digestive system and it does not allow you to heal.
Yeah, interesting. Tell us more about your exercise. What did you find and what do you do now to give the best results, to make your joints feel the best?
Now what I do, I go for, like, I listen to my body. Like your body is not same every day. So I don't have any fixed schedule, like on this time I exercise or this time I will eat. Now I listen to my body. I'm completely in present moment. So I can sense my hunger. Only when I'm hungry, I will eat food. If I'm not hungry, I will not eat food. And your hunger also not like slightly hungry. You should be very hungry. And earlier I was like, I was so lazy. I would tell my mom to bring my food on table. But now I go inside the kitchen. I make my own food. I cut vegetables. So when you're already hungry and you go to the kitchen and you cut vegetables, then more hunger, more digestive juices are released. Then when you eat the food, that food is properly digested. So usually what people are watching movie and on one side and they're eating burger on one side. So there is no enough digestive juices to digest all that processed stuff. So it goes undigested into the intestine and it remains there in intestines for years. It does not get digested.
Yeah, I think that's possibly one of the most overlooked area of the strategies of healing is only eat when you're hungry. You know, the power of that is immense, and yet the number of times that people adhere to that and to follow that is not so common. Snacking is very, very common, especially when we think we've got to get more calories in and so forth. Snacking happens all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Snacking is a terrible thing for the digestive process. It never gets a chance to rest, you know. And I in the book by Hiromi Shinya, The Enzyme Factor, which is one of my favorites, and it was an influential book for me. And in fact, it was sort of some of the pioneering sort of work that he did gave me the idea around the two grain mix and the whole pseudo grains and buckwheat and quinoa, combining them together and stuff. That all came originally from ideas from The Enzyme Factor and Dr. Shinya. And his quote, "Make friends with gentle hunger," is just such a beautiful quote. Make friends with gentle hunger, because he explains that when the bodies are not digesting, it's healing. And so it all ties in with eating when hungry, and then when you're not hungry, let it heal. It's like a mini fast in between your meals. So great insight.
Yeah, actually that's where mind power comes into picture. Because even I have to work, still I have to work hard. Like I reach out to like nuts or for snacking, but I have to tell my mind, no, Seema, you have to wait so that you are sufficiently hungry for the next meal. Like as much as possible, I try to control, because I know if I snack, then my hunger will go, then I'll not able to eat that next dinner.
That's right. That's totally right. So let's say it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon and we're starting to get hungry and we've got a big meal coming at 5:30, maybe we're eating at 6 o'clock, which is a good time to eat. So we're all done by 7 o'clock. So we're not pushing food into our body when it's not designed to eat food into the dark hours. And so that's really a time when we want to avoid getting really hungry. So we either need to have a bigger lunch so that we don't start getting hungry at 4 o'clock, or we just allow the hunger to build and we have an earlier dinner and we eat a lot at dinner. We eat a lot of good food at dinner and satiate ourselves. Because if we're to have then a big snack at 4 and then dinner comes and it's 5:30 and we're not that hungry, but we eat everything on our plate, we're not going to feel good tomorrow. We're going to have pain.
Yes, exactly.
So, yes. All right, great. Well, I'm glad you covered that one. Tell us about the you talked about the visualization fairly briefly earlier. You mentioned visualizing becoming pain-free and drug-free and so on. Let's talk more about this mindset, because before we started recording, you mentioned to me is one of the most important things for you, and it could just be the missing link for a lot of other people, because whilst everyone can get really, really high scores out of 10 for their diet and exercise, if things are still not working, you know, deep down subconsciously, something might be just a pattern in our thoughts, or something could be holding us back. So tell us, other than just saying the affirmations and visualizing pain-free and drug-free and back to maximum energy, did you said you also changed jobs so that you felt happier more often?
Yes. Earlier, I was working as a forex trader.
Oh, wow.
And in that, market would fluctuate and my thought would also fluctuate along with the market. Like when market is going according to my trade, then I would feel happy. When it is not going according to what I had speculated, then I would get so depressed, because like a lot of money is also involved.
Yeah, yeah. So, wow, that's like, a really tough job.
Yes, exactly. You'll see most of the dealers and all, they face some or the other health problem. I think it is because of this.
Yeah, that's stressful.
Were you investing
other people's money?
No. Yes, it was other people's money were investing.
Yeah.
I was trading on the behalf of company.
Yeah, so the weight of the company's finances is on your shoulders.
Yeah.
God, that's stressful. Okay, so I can see why that was playing a role. And so how did you, I mean, did you decide that you're going to leave the company and just go off and try and heal? Or what did you do? Because I imagine that was quite a good career.
Yeah. No, the company business operations got shifted and it shut down its operation in Mumbai. So at that time I got time to evaluate myself, evaluate my health, because everything was going fine with career. There is one Newton's law of motion, or when some external force does not come, you stay on that same track. If this external force wouldn't have been happened, then I wouldn't have found you also, because during that time I did my research and I came across your program. I was at home na that time. So yeah. I was like research, Googling. I came across your TED talk. So I was like, that's why I believe like whatever happens, it is for good. Mm. Like you come to know about that later. In Bhagavad Gita also it is written. Like whatever is happening, it is for good. Whatever has happened, it is for good. And whatever is going to happen in future, it is going to be very, very good. So now I come to know like, I was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis. There is some reason. Maybe God has given me purpose for that. So when I look back, like everything is clear. What has happened to me? Why happened to me? That time I used to ask, why this thing happened to me? Like rheumatoid arthritis, why only me? And that time you feel so depressed. You tend to think so negative. And it has cascading effect on all the rest of the thoughts. Your day, your entire month goes like waste.
Yeah.
But now everything seems to be fine.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's the transformation is huge. You know, as you said, the mindset.
I'm a completely different person now compared to 10 years back.
Yeah.
Like earlier, I used to get angry very fast. But all these years I've trained my mind. Now, I don't get angry even if things are not going according to my way. Maybe this disease has taught me that. Because, you know, our body and our symptoms were not in our control. But still, we had to work towards healing. Maybe that thing has taught us and I'm able to apply that in rest of other aspects of my life as well.
Well, I think you can't possibly distinguish between the two. You know, your experience with a very, very serious health condition shapes you as a person and shapes your thoughts, and it shapes your ability to have compassion for others with who are having health problems. It shapes the way that you spend your time with your education. It shapes your exercise and dietary patterns. It shapes your social behaviors and who you spend time with and how you spend time with them. And I mean, it virtually is the sort of backbone of all of your actions and thoughts and everything, because when you're getting pain coming into your body and into your mind, it's unignorable. And so it drives all these different behaviors. So I want to drill down more. I want to pick your brains because you have a personality that is uplifting and happy and joyful. And for people's sort of background here as well, all of our communication prior to this recording, you've just been so positive and so upbeat and so looking forward to this. And you've just been so pleasant in our brief communications, and we've had to postpone this, I think, because the hurricane or, you know, here in Florida and a few things, and you've just been so like happy about the whole thing. And I think, you know, people can see how much you smile and how genuinely like, I guess joyful
like this
you
was
are.
My dream. Like 3 years back, I had visualized, like, I'm doing podcast with Clint Patterson. I had told my mom, like, one day I will be on this podcast. And I was like 100% sure, you see, I will be there. And today, like, it is real thing. Like, I am still having goosebumps. I just cannot believe, like, it is happening. So I believe truly in this power of visualization. Yeah. So everyone in the community, I want to say that you visualize positive thing and it will happen. Because your brain cannot differentiate between what is real and what you're visualizing. So if you can visualize, then we can go for it, right? We are naturally inclined to be happy, positive.
Yeah.
God has not designed the body and mind to be always in negativity and depression. So if we comply with the law of nature and always be happy and positive, that will reflect in our body also, and it will speed up the healing process. Because you might have seen in my journal, like within 3 months, ESR dropped from 40 to 11, and still it is in that range, 15. Because like all diet changes and exercise, I have already mentioned, but like 80%, I feel it is in mind. I've read about one book about Dr. Joseph Murphy also. He says that in one of the region, he said that people eat and drink everything, but they are so happy, they are full of joy, filled with laughter, that city or town is filled with laughter, and they are living up to age of 150. Like somewhere near Himalaya, that village is there. One scientist went there and he researched why the people are living such a long life. So he found out that people are very happy. They are full of love. They are passionate towards their work. They do farming and all. So that's why there is no disease in that village, and everyone are living happily together. So I think that is main reason that disease is growing. Because people are so depressed now, because even for small thing, if pen is lost, then they will get angry and irritated. Such a small thing, just for a small pen. If your mom shouts at you, then you're angry. So instead, now I trained my mind, like, even if my mom shouts at me, I'll smile at her. Mom, I love you so much, you're great. And she will like go away. There is no argument then.
Wow.
So we should I changed my approach in every aspect of my life.
Yeah. It's a powerful technique, and by no means is it easy. Yeah. You know, I've still got some curiosity around how you actually managed to achieve that. One thing that comes to my mind is the concept of interpretation. So, you know, if two people go on a roller coaster and one person interprets the roller coaster as being an exciting, wonderful experience that's going to be totally fun, then their body will release endorphins and they will have the experience they expected. The other person on the roller coaster, if they think it's terrifying and really, really frightening. And they get on there, they will have that experience. Their body will release inflammatory markers, and they will actually have a physiological experience that is negative for them. So the two people had the same experience. One interpreted it one way and got positive health benefits, and one got negative health benefits, same experience. So interpretation is so key. So, you know, you interpreted, I guess, your interpretation of why did you get this disease. At first you thought, well, why me? Why am I the only one, and how that awful this is? And now I think you've interpreted it as an opportunity to contribute and to help other people and to maybe change lives of people, particularly in India, where I think it can be challenging to access some of the same resources as in, you know, some of the more bigger Western countries. Is that how you feel as well? Has that helped towards feeling more happy? Has it helped more to feel the interpretation of why maybe you've been going through all this? Is that maybe you can help people?
Yes, now because I've found my purpose of life. Like now I can, because all my experiences I can share with, when I share with others, only then my life will be meaningful. Like when I will add value to others. Like our God, like we come on this earth and we'll go one day, but what we will do on this planet earth is what matters. So that when you find your purpose and you do what you love, your work is no more a work. So you don't have that stress hormones when you're doing the work that you don't love. Like when you get up in the morning, you should be excited. Like, yes, I'm going to do this. So like disease will miraculously vanish when, because your attention is not going towards where attention flows, energy goes, something like that you had told in one of the videos. So when your attention is towards positive things, then your energy flows towards that. And where energy flows, things grow.
Absolutely.
So all this plays an important role in your healing journey. Like healing journeys, I felt it is not just about diet. Yes, diet is very important. It is 100% actually. But there is some 500% apart from diet, like your thought. There is thought patterns and all this thing, your habit. It is one huge universe inside your mind. So you have to control your thoughts. Actually, I worked a lot. I've read many articles and research papers, and I follow some mentors online as well, like who explain about thoughts, like how to control thoughts and how to remain. I have grown spiritually as well.
Yes.
So spirituality also, I read stuff related to spirituality. I think maybe that has conditioned my mind. Because here also my friends, they say that you think differently and you're a little weird. Like you don't think like us. So because of arthritis, you may be knowing social life is not that great. Most of the time I was at home.
Yeah.
In contemplating spirituality, spending time spending time with great people on internet. Because of internet, I could come in contact with you. So like most of the time I was spending time with people who was adding more value to me, like you. Like there's so many mentors you can find online today.
Yeah.
So all this has made me conditioned my mind little differently. So
yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
And what do you think at the moment that your life's purpose is?
My life purpose is to help people reverse their disease with rheumatoid arthritis, especially because I want to help someone who was just like me. Like I suffered so much at this young age, and people used to tell like how at this young age you got arthritis. And I want to create awareness like this arthritis is not like normal arthritis. This can occur at any age. So when people are aware about this disease, it will also help in early diagnosis and it will help many people live normal life. So I want to reach out to all those people who are in pain and suffering. So if I'm able to help even one person, then I would feel great. I would feel great for my existence on this planet Earth.
Hmm.
I would have a meaning in my life. Because if there is no meaning, I don't know what to do when I get up, then your life is meaningless.
Yeah.
So actually things should flow from what God, right? Like you have given me. So from me, things should go to someone else. When things flow from your body, then disease won't remain in your body. When people want to keep everything secret, people don't want to share, everything gets stuck in your body, and that takes forms of disease. When even in the form of emotions, when emotions people don't share and they keep it inside their heart for long years and years, then that emotion takes form of disease. So it should flow. You should show love to others. You should show care. You should show affection to people around you, your fam. Charity begins at home. So you should love your family. You should take care of family. So all these things matter. So when energy does not flow from your body, the disease takes some form.
It gets trapped.
So when I'm able to help many people, it will flow. So I will also be healthy and others will also become healthy.
Yeah, I love it. I've written down flow, and I'm going to tell that one to Melissa because that one is golden. Flow is fantastic. I love the concept of it. I've never talked about it or heard someone talk about it before. It is absolutely fantastic because, you know, I think about, you know, things that that I still want to share, other things that I've learned and talk about, and it makes me excited. The feeling of flow and passing on thoughts and ideas is one that feels natural for us. And I'm sure anyone who's watching this has the things they want to share, they want to do, they want to move out of something that's been floating in their head for weeks, months, and possibly years, and get it out there and put it out there. And it feels good, and it's a healing, it's a cleansing process because it makes way for new things.
Yes, if you are not talking to someone for many years, then write a letter. I'm sorry, I did this. And become friends with them. If you cannot tell sorry, then in your mind, you tell sorry to that person and release the emotion. Because I also did this. I used to write letter also to my family. I used to write gratitude letter to my family. Like pen and paper, today world has forgotten. But pen and paper is the most effective form of communication. Today everyone are communicating on mobile and the relation breaks so fast.
Yeah.
If relation gets, they are able to make relationships so fast without even understanding. All the social media is making this emotional world very complicated.
Yeah.
So you have to control that social media usage also. Like in community, I read one of your posts. You had told you should remain cut off from, away from Facebook distraction, something like that you're written.
Yeah.
So I cut down all the social media during my healing period. I told I want to remain with myself during that healing. Now I'm like full. I have outside on the social media because I have some purpose on social media. So that's why I've come on social media.
So you use it because it helps you to connect with other people who you feel that you can really help. I mean, I have to as well. I have to go onto Instagram and reply to people's questions, and I have to post new things from time to time because the amount of information that's being posted that's wrong by all the other, you know, people who have these other views are clouding and crowding out the space. And so if I don't, and other people like yourself, and other people who know the truth are not posting regularly, or at least somewhat, then our message doesn't even exist. And the one that's important is just being buried. Yeah.
Exactly. I saw one post like meat is getting deep fried in oil, and that Instagram post has 10 million views. Imagine 10 million people inside their brain that post went, and they might have felt like eating that immediately.
Yeah. It couldn't do anything worse. What could be worse?
Yeah.
Eating meat deep fried in oil. I mean, there's not much worse for the body than that. That's crazy.
Yeah. And the people that post is reaching out to, that is a huge number.
Yeah.
And all our post, it is reaching out to just few number of people.
I know.
We have to work hard.
It is true. It is true. A comment that I often get on YouTube is, why does this guy only have 10,000 followers or something?
Exactly.
Because like cat videos have 500,000 followers, people who post videos of their cat. And what I believe that we're putting out on our YouTube channel and so forth and other platforms is stuff that can change people's lives. And you get 10,000 for life-changing stuff and 500,000 for a cat that scratches its ear with its paw, you know. But that's just how the world is. And rather than, you know, we talk about interpretation, right? Rather than interpretation that as disappointing or frustrating, I interpret that as there are 10,000 people who want to hear my message and want to hear your stories.
Exactly.
And that is where you focus. Not on the 490 that aren't there. It's the 10,000 that are really, really passionate about this information and actually get value from it and want more of it. So that's where my focus is at.
Yes,
so
exactly.
I think you have wisdom way beyond your years, and I've got family members who believe in multiple lives, and they would say that your wisdom has evolved over multiple lives, and and that you're a very wise soul. So that's what I would say, and I mean that in the most deeply complimentary way.
You've got this wonderful
combination of youthful beauty, but also this deep spiritual wisdom. And that combination is remarkable. So,
this wouldn't have been possible without you.
Oh, thank you. That's nice. Well, you know, we put the content out there, and now you're helping to create some wisdom around this as well, and we put another piece of the puzzle together, and we continue to share, and hope that another person hears the right message at the right time to make the decisions that they need to make to get the outcomes they've been visualizing and saying affirmations for, just like you have been.
Yes.
So thank you, Seema. I think we might wrap it up there. Congratulations on how far you've come with your physical symptoms. I know that you're living a very, very comfortable life now on only a very small amount of methotrexate. You're moving into a completely different direction and going to be helping other people. And hopefully this is a good start towards that as well.
Yes, and thanks a lot for giving me chance to reach out to people who are in your community. I pray that all in your community get well fast. Like, your community support forum was so helpful. Everyone used to motivate me when I used to feel down. Like, the support is very important. Just by reading, it cannot help. So when I got into the support, your community, when you pushed me, used to stay on track. That, I think, played a major role to keep me motivated, to keep that belief, the flame of belief alive in my mind. So that kept me going. So I am immensely grateful. Like I cannot express in words, like, so much grateful I am. Like, this, I'm talking, I'm doing everything today. It's all because of you created your content on internet, and you made your efforts to reach out to me Like, still, I would have been lying on bed. Like, so I want to thank you from bottom of my heart.
Oh, you're very, very welcome.
For all your efforts.
Thank you, Seema. Thank you for sharing. And as I said, congratulations on what you've done. Keep up the great work and keep doing all the right things and looking after your body just the way that you've been, and you'll continue to have the wonderful results. So thanks again.
Thank you so much.